I'll do an audio one just in case, because I think the video cuts out after, sometimes cuts out. All right, good morning, saints. Hagios, as the Greek says, those who are sanctified and set apart. The Catholic Church for many years wanted us to think that just the dead, most righteous and holy type people are saints, but we here together are saints in Christ, set apart for him and for his purposes. This is not the most robust pulpit, so let's just hope it all holds together. And, okay, I think that's working. How is everybody this morning? All good?
Good.
Ready to get some word into you? I have a habit of pacing, which I'm not allowed to do, so I'm going to try to exercise some self-control and restraint, because otherwise I'll move in out of this all the time, which is no good for people who do choose to watch it. So, this morning, what's been on my heart in preparing this week and just reflecting are two Greek words, doulos, which means a slave or a bondservant, and diakonos, which is an attendant or a servant. And I think the challenge we face as Christians is both understanding the work of the cross and what that really means and the price that's been paid and the debt that we owe to Jesus because of that. And secondly, the challenge is understanding that God's heart is for us to come into submission to his will and to lay our lives down and to be a living sacrifice. Now, those are two very hard things, both to understand God's work on the cross and to understand God's work that he wants to do in us and through us. Very hard, okay? I say that because most of the church misses both of those things, and most Christians just kind of, you know, escape through the flames and get into heaven one day and like, oh, wow, there was actually a lot more that could have happened here, but didn't, because I didn't understand, right? There was a lack of understanding, a lack of revelation. That's why Paul prays for the church that they would receive the spirit of revelation and understanding, because with revelation and understanding, you can actually rightly serve God and be useful to God. God wants to use you. He has a purpose for your life, more than just saving up money for when you retire one day and hope that your health is good enough to go to a tropical island or a cruise for 30 days around the world, which is awesome, and I hope to do that one day. But that's not the purpose of our lives, okay? God wants to use you to do his will for his good purposes. Do you understand that? Mm-hmm. All right. And that is rooted firstly in a correct understanding of the cross, because when we understand the awful price that Jesus paid to purchase us, to ransom us from our sin and our iniquity and our awfulness as humans, all right? We don't have to have a theological degree to understand the world is broken and that humans are messed up. You don't need to have a theology degree for that. In fact, if you just spend a little bit of time looking at your own heart, you don't have to realize, it doesn't take great wisdom and revelation to realize that you're pretty messed up inside too, okay? And at the cross, all of this messed up stuff can be surrendered and God can begin the journey of healing us and sanctifying us and helping us to have hope and purpose, which are the two things that humanity desperately needs. We need hope. To have a healthy and successful life, you need hope and you need a purpose. Okay, without those two things, you'll jump off a bridge. Or at worst, you'll end up watching, playing computer games and drinking yourself into oblivion, right? Like some people do. And they'll have their bottle of whiskey and six beers. I know people like that. And they'll, you know, cigarettes, whatever. And that's their escape from having no purpose and no hope. And they're just waiting for the grave. And that's not what Jesus has for us. He actually wants us to enjoy our lives. He actually wants us to be purposeful. He actually wants us to be full of hope and to be able to bring hope into dark circumstances and situations. All right? We shouldn't be defined by our situations and our circumstances. But the more that we are attached to our possessions, the more that we're attached to our own life, the more that we're attached to people, the more that we're attached to stuff, the harder it is to actually have hope and purpose. Because attachment produces fear. It produces a fear of loss. What if I lose my kids? What if I lose my job? What if I lose my money? What if my pension goes out the window because the government decides to put their sticky fingers on it, etc., 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 right? There's hyperinflation. Oh, no. Well, you know, fear. And the world, the system of this world is a system of fear. Everything is about fear. Whether it's sickness or your savings or your retirement. What if you don't have enough money? What if, you know, agony. That's not Christianity. That's not Christ. Christianity is, I've learned to be content whether I have little or whether I have much. It doesn't matter because I'm crucified with Christ. I live in Christ. I live for Christ. And if he chooses to bless me with stuff, awesome. And if he chooses not to for a season, awesome. Because in that place, he's with me. And in fact, it's very dangerous to be in a place where you have too much, because that's where you lose sight of him. And your flesh takes a much more prominent place. Suffering is an amazing gift to the church. As hard as that's to understand, suffering is one of the things that often brings us back to him, sickness and so forth, because we just get so, as humans, we're so easily distracted, we're so easily tempted, we so easily will just, and I speak of myself, invest hours into videos, computer games, distractions, whatever, you know, because we're humans. Like, that's the inbuilt default weakness. We will be distracted by stuff. It's like, oh, that shines. Let me have a look at it. You know, like birds, like crows, like pick up all their shiny things. That's humans. It's like, oh, there's a new series. Oh, there's a new computer game. Oh, there's a new this. There's a new that. Oh. And we get so, again, this world system is geared for that. It's consumerism and all the marketing around that. So if we're not caught up in fear, we're caught up in stuff. The whole point of that, the devil's system is, he's the prince of air, is to stop you looking above these things and actually realizing God has a purpose for you, for your life. And then actually letting go of these addictions and entrapments and starting to get free and live simply and live more minimalistically and be more independent of the system and more independent of the government and so forth and so on and more dependent on him. All right, how's that for an introduction? Are we on the same page? All right, let's see. So I wanted to talk about these two things, right? Rightly understanding the cross and the rightly understanding our identity. And these two words in Greek are really key and so hard to understand. The doulos and the diakonos. Okay, excuse my wonderful writing. Diakonos and doulos. Can you see that from the back there? Okay, so in Greek, right, understand that the Bible was originally written, the Old Testament, in Hebrew Aramaic, and the New Testament was written in Greek. Okay, the apostles, although they were Jewish, they wrote the Bible in the trade language of the day, which like now is English, in those days it was Greek, so what we get here is Greek. Now, the problem is that the Greek text was translated to Latin during the reign of the Catholic Church, and only priests could read it, and Tyndale and all these amazing heroes in the 15th century, so on, 16th century, were put to death and burnt at the stake. There are cases even of mothers and fathers being burnt at the stake for teaching their children the Lord's Prayer in English. Okay, that's how serious the government was in controlling the access to the Word, or denying access to the Word. And so many hundreds of people were burnt at the stake to get this translated into English for us, right? The Bible at one point in England was the hottest black market property you could purchase when it was starting to get printed and smuggled in. And the king actually put aside a whole lump sum to send out agents to buy up as many as he could to get them off the market. Anyway, that's not the point. It was written in Greek, taken to Latin, and then from Latin eventually was transferred to English. And so we have a hangover, a Latin hangover in our translations, all right? The King James, which was eventually the official translation, being taken from the Vulgate, it had a Latin hangover. And one of those hangovers is the word choices that we get in English, all right? So for example, diakonos, this word, which is an attendant, one who attends, sort of like a waiter, it can also mean someone who runs errands. All right, somebody who's not high up in society here, right? He's a servant, does errands, attends tables, waits on tables, all right? That's a diakonos. Now, the diakonos in the English translation can be servant. It can obviously be deacon. And it's also translated minister. Now, this word minister is interesting because the Latin word minister, it's literally spelled exactly the same as that. That's Latin, it's direct Latin. The word minister in Latin just means servant. So when they translated the Bible from Greek to Latin, everywhere that there was diakonos, they just put minister. You understand that in the Latin translation. And then when it was translated to English, there seems to have been a split somewhere in using the word minister from the Latin to describe a position. So whenever you read the Bible and it says, Paul, a minister of the gospel, a minister of this, or you know, my fellow ministers, or wherever you read the word minister, if you're reading the Greek, you just see the word servant. Servant of Christ, servant of the gospel, fellow servant. There's no understanding in the Greek text of minister as a position. Because if you're like me, when you read the Bible and Paul says, I'm a minister of the gospel, we have an understanding now that a minister of the gospel is someone who's been ordained, who's officially in a church hierarchy. Am I right? Okay? That's not in the Greek. Wherever you see that word minister, it just means servant. And so it's actually, to me, it's helpful when I read the Bible and you see these different ways the Greek and Latin has been translated. It just means servant. And it in some small, subtle ways, changes your reading of Scripture, okay? Likewise, the word deacon, for example, we'll turn to Philippians and read this, where Paul says, to the saints in Philippi, he says, I don't want to butcher it because it's such a wonderful verse, but he says, to Paul and Timothy, who are the doulos of Christ, let me write that, what that means. That means slave, all right? The slaves of Christ. It can also mean bond servant. And in some cases, it can just mean servant. So in the English scripture, when you read the word servant, it's typically 9 times out of 10 will either be doulos or diakonos. And you have to just look at the Greek. If you've got Esau, it's very easy. The program Esau, I highly recommend it. And so Paul uses this word doulos in slightly different contexts. For example, 1 Corinthians 7, I believe it is, it says, whatever you were when you became a Christian, don't try and be something else. If you were a doulos, that's fine. If you can get your freedom, great. But don't worry about it, because the doulos in Christ is a doulos in the world is a free man in Christ, and a free man in the world is a doulos in Christ. All right, he just uses wordplay. He says, if you're a slave, you know what, you're actually free in Christ, and if you're free, you're actually a slave in Christ. You following? Okay, so that's the word doulos. And he starts in Philippians 1, we'll read it. He says, Paul and Timothy, doulos of Christ, we write to the saints, the hagios of Philippi, which is everybody there. And he says, and to the bishops, the overseers, the word episkopos, we get episcopalian, it just means overseers, superintendents of the church, and the deacons, the diakonoia, all right? So he specifies the saints, the hagios, and the diakonoia, the deacons. So what I'm trying to get at is that all of the saints are always diakonoia. We are all attendants of Christ, but there are some who in a church context will be appointed to certain tasks. And they are just known as deacons in the English. Is that making sense? All right. I hope we will follow it. So let's look at some of this. First, I want to start, if we can read, there's two bits of scripture I'd like to read today. Is this Matthew 20, verse 26? Sorry, my voice is going here. Okay, Matthew 20, 26, if you turn there. In fact, I think I'll start with 25. Jesus called his disciples to him, right? So he's addressing his disciples. And he says to them, now this is a key text, and it's not at all seen in the, by and large, in the modern church, which is very sad. But Jesus said to his apostles to be, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. It shall not be so amongst you. But whoever would be great amongst you must be your servant. And whoever would be first amongst you must be your slave. All right. So that what's interesting in this text, it's that word servant is diakonos, and the word slave is doulos. So Jesus is using those. He wasn't speaking then in Greek, but when Matthew, who was the apostle who recorded this, wrote it down, he used those words. And he said, so whoever would be great amongst you, talking to his disciples and knowing that they would clearly pass those teachings on to the church to be, he said, whoever would be great amongst you must be your attendant, your diakonos. And whoever would be first must be your doulos, your slave. Even as, this is verse 28, the Son of Man came not to be served, not to diakonoia, that's the verb of diakonos, that's the noun, so the verb is diakonoia, not to diakonoia, not to serve, but to serve, diakonoia, and give his life as a ransom for many. So Jesus himself said, I've come to be a servant, the diakonoia. You understand that? And he said, if you want to be great in this world as a Christian, you must be like me. And you must be an attendant to whoever he tells you to be an attendant to. People around you, people you're ministering to, your family. But be less. That's the idea of these, right? The idea, what have these got in common? What have they got in common? The idea of subjection, being less than others, being lower. And very important, I was talking to my wife about this. What is the defining nature of a servant? Being inconvenienced. All right? Think about it. If you serve people, I don't know how to spell inconvenience. How do you spell inconvenience? Is it two I's? Inconvenience. Is that? No,
there's
double. Is that EDI?
Inconvenience.
There we go. Don't worry. Sorry, I hardly passed English. So what have they got in common? Whether it's the doulos or the diakonos, they exist in relationship with a master. Alright, you understand that? If you're a slave, you have a master. If you're an attendant, you have a master. So they're in subjection and in a relationship with a master figure. There has to be someone greater in authority. All right, so there's an authority to which they are subjected. They are lower in rank, lower in standing, and they are inconvenienced to serve that master. Maybe they paid, maybe they're not. The idea of a doulos is you're not paid. An attendant might be paid, the doulos is not. That's the big difference. The doulos does not get rewarded and compensated for his service and his inconvenience. And secondly, or lastly, fourthly, whatever we have now, the important element that's in common between these words is this. Whose will is being done? Yours, the servant's, or the master's?
Master.
So there is, in this subjection, there is no self-will, but it's the master's will that gets done. Those who are joined with Christ Jesus, it says in Galatians 5, 24, 25, around there, have crucified their passions and desires with him. All right? So the Old Testament is based on different rules. It has different promises. It's a shadow. But, for example, the Old Testament says that those who please God and do his will and all of that, he will give them the desires of their heart. The New Testament turns that around and says those who are joined with God, who are subjected to Christ and become his servants, they actually get to crucify their desires with Christ. Very different. Very different covenants. The Old Testament was a reward curse system. The New Testament is just a subjection and die system. And then live again. Okay, let's not forget the live again part. We live in Christ, but we have to die to ourselves. We have to let go. We have to empty ourselves to be filled with Christ. Does that make sense? Yep. The Old Testament had nothing of that. The Old Testament was come and bring a physical offering. Some dude will you know, lay hands on a goat or a sheep and be like, go, you know, get out of here. That's now the scapegoat with your sins on it, and put it on the altar and kill it. And you know, okay, cool, another year of sin. Woohoo, you know. Very different system. And if you did right, God would bless you and you know, look after you. And if you did wrong, God would curse you. Very, very simple system. You know, it was quite elegant in its design. You know, there's the reward and there's punishment. Choose life or death. Your call. That's not complicated. A kid can understand that. But the New Testament is totally different to that Old Testament system. It's not based on rewards and punishments. It's based on a new life. Becoming a new creation. That's radically different, people. Radically different. And when you become a new creation, then by nature, with the Holy Spirit in you, you fulfill the requirements of the law. So it's not like the law is now, you know, cancelled. That's fulfilled. All right? So those requirements are met within us, but we're not buying down to some laws and rules that will be cursed if you don't follow them. That's all Old Testament. In the New Testament, you have a new life, a new creation. And because you have the Holy Spirit, you automatically will be inclined to do those things that God wants you to do. Where before you had to punish people to scare them into doing it. You understand? All right? Much, much better system. Anyway, so I wanted to share Matthew 20 to understand a few things. One, Jesus is our chief diakonos. He's the chief attendant. He laid down his divinity to come and serve who? Us and God, firstly. But he came to be an attendant to God, to man. Does that make sense? And if Jesus did that, how much more do we owe a debt to him to be the same and to do the same? Does that understand that? All right. Now let's go to the next scripture, which I want to read is Philippians, the letter of Paul's epistle to the Philippian church. And we'll start here with 1 verse 1. Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, okay, as I said, that's doulos, slaves of Christ, to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are at Philippi, with the overseers, which is that word episkopos, and the deacons, diakonos. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, so that's the introduction. Let's have a look now at Philippians 2 verse 5, if you go to the next chapter. It's such a beautiful letter. It's one of Paul's prison epistles, very, very beautiful. Anyway, he says, have this mind amongst yourselves, church, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself, and he took the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of man. And that word servant is, of course, doulos. So we see in Matthew, in the previous one, what was it, Matthew 20, sorry, my mind's a bit, Matthew 20, yeah, 20, 26. We see there Jesus being referred to as the diakonos, the attendant of God who came. And here in Philippians, we see he emptied himself and he became a slave, a bondservant to God. You understand that? So he did both for us. And then if you carry on looking down, chapter 2, verse 13, well, let's go from 12. It says, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. So this thing of will, you'll see it comes up quite often in the New Testament. And there, in the same chapter, it gives us this picture of how Jesus, who is God, gave up his divinity, and that's the fullness of his divinity. He was still divine on earth, to come into incarnation, becoming a slave and a servant for our sake, okay, and to do the will of God. Did he do his own will? No. He said, I've come to do my Father's will. And so you see that same theme follows to us as the church, that we are called to do his will, to do God's will, not our own will. We are walking out our salvation, all right, with fear and trembling. In other words, we must have some awe of God. And there's this expectation that God will actually work in us by his Holy Spirit, by the power of his Holy Spirit, to both will and work for his good pleasure. So it's not that we don't have to do this alone. That's the wonderful promise, hey? We don't have to do this alone. The Holy Spirit strengthens us to actually do God's will through our life. So dying to self, in its essence, is dying to self-will. I want this. I want to do that. I want to go here. I want to have this. I need, I must have. That thing dies at the cross. Do you understand? And when we can get there, and we're not driven by our own wants and our own conveniences and our own necessities and our own everythings, we can actually finally see God starting to work in us to do his will and not our will. Okay? And this is a process, guys. Don't get me wrong. It's not instant. I've been a Christian for 20 odd years. 20 years. And many times, the stubbornness of my heart has prevailed over the work of God in me to will to his good pleasure. Many times. Stubbornness is one of the greatest human weaknesses. All right? The stubbornness of our will. That thing trips us up all the time. I shouldn't watch so much TV. Ah, but you get there and you do it anyway. I shouldn't, in my case, play so much computer gaming, but I do it anyway. I shouldn't, you know, whatever. I shouldn't, but you do it anyway. Why? Because of the stubbornness of our will. And so it takes time, and it takes devotion. It does take, you have to actually seek Christ. You have to be reading the word. You know, there's no effort. You can't sell a Christianity where there's no effort. The effort is not for salvation. The effort is for intimacy. Okay? It's like if you're married, you don't work every day to stay married. You work every day with your marriage to grow in intimacy. You understand that? So I've been married 7 years now, I think, wife, around there. And we have much greater intimacy after 7 years than we did when we began, because we've learned about each other. We've learned what pleases each other. We've learned what irritates each other. We've learned, you know, what earns brownie points. You know what I'm saying? It's like for us, it's been 7 years, and the first few years was more difficult, much more difficult, because you have all these expectations and stubbornness and all these stories. You have to die to yourself. And if you do that, if you're willing to be less selfish and less self-centered and all these things, your marriage gets better. The opposite is also true. And then people get divorced. So it's like there's a place where Paul uses marriage as the analogy for our relationship with Jesus. And there's a reason for that, because both are based around intimacy. And intimacy is impossible if there's selfishness. Intimacy is impossible if the self-will is dominant. And it can be one partner, you know, it can be both, or it can be one, but intimacy is not possible when one person is all about me and what I want. Does that make sense? And so this picture of marriage and our intimacy with Christ stands as well. Like Jesus is never the guilty party, right? You understand? We're always the guilty party. If there's a problem of intimacy in our spiritual life, where's the problem? It's your heart. It's in you. I promise you that is a given. It doesn't, as again, not a, you don't need a theological degree. The love of God is poured out without measure through the Holy Spirit. That's a promise of Scripture. But what stops us receiving it is this corrupt thing of the old man, the old flesh, which much prefers living how it always has lived than dying so that the new man can actually have dominance. So I hope that encourages you. I'm trying to get across what's been in my heart, because for me, this is, I think when you share a message or you preach, you're always wanting it to first of all land at your own doorstep. And so I've been really meditating on these two concepts. What does it mean for me to be a doulos? Because you don't have to be a doulos. You don't have to be. You don't have to be a slave of Christ. You don't have to, or a bond slave of Christ. I don't know how you wouldn't want to be, but you don't have to be. But if you are, what does that mean? What does that look like? Because this is the thing. Every single apostle called himself a doulos. Every apostle that wrote us an epistle. So John, in Revelation 1 verse 1, he says the angel spoke to his servant, the doulos. Jude 1 verse 1. Peter, it's, I think to Peter he refers to himself as the doulos. Paul, obviously, many times, and he refers to his attendants like Apollos and Timothy and Epaphras and Tacchus and so forth. He all calls them doulos, or there's the other Greek word sundoulos, which is fellow slave. Okay, these are my fellow slaves. So to me, the only right progression as a Christian, if you truly understand Jesus and that he was a slave, that he was the bondservant, he was the attendant of God, he willingly constrained himself to that. If you understand that, and we are, the whole point of our journey, right, is to become like Jesus. Ephesians 4, it's a mind-blowing chapter in particular where it says that God's aim for us in growing into maturity is to become unto the fullness of the full stature of Christ. I'm butchering, but that's more or less what it says. That's actually the destiny of the Christian, is to come to the full stature of the fullness of Christ. What does that even mean? I don't know. But it starts with us realizing we have to become like him. Do you understand? And if he was the slave and a servant of God, how much more should we be? So I don't want to belabor the point more than I need to, but that's what I just want to leave with you guys, that you can go away from here, hopefully, and ask, have I made myself willingly a doulos, a bond slave of Christ? Because that's the right thing to do. That's clearly the call of Scripture for us, is to become the doulos and the diakonos of Christ. All right? And if that's the case or isn't the case, what am I going to do about it? How do I go forward with this? All right? I'm sharing this not just that it's like, oh, that's nice, ear tickling stuff. I'm sharing this so that you can go away and think about it and ask yourself, if I have this understanding I'm a servant of God, how deeply has that penetrated my life? Because let me tell you, I've met many pastors. And unfortunately, it's a habit of the church. Because the church didn't listen to Jesus' instructions and it's filled itself with great men who want to lord authority over everybody, unfortunately, that then creates church leaders who don't at all resemble slaves and servants. And it's quite fascinating because one of the things that you know that a person's not a servant of Christ is if they are irritated or bothered by inconvenience. Then you know there's an issue in their heart towards this understanding of servanthood, and they position themselves as a master, not a servant. So it's very common in the church for church leaders to position themselves, often unconsciously, as masters. And they will expect everybody to do their will and be inconvenienced on their behalf. But as soon as they're inconvenienced for something, it puts their back up and they get put out. Then you know there's a serious issue there with the understanding of what it means to be a servant of Christ. And, you know, whatever. The point is that we have to reflect on our position. If other people don't get it, that's their issue. But I'll leave you with this thought, because I don't want to carry on for too long. But the definition of being a servant is being willing to be inconvenienced. If you give yourself to God's will and you say, Lord, do whatever you want in my life at whatever cost, I'm yours. That's a great place to start. if you do that, I can guarantee you that inconvenience becomes one of the main elements of your life. Okay, for 6 years, my wife and I have been serving God together in ministry. We've moved house more times than I can count. I'd say major moves with furniture and everything, 6 or 7 times in 6 years at least, and many other minor moves around that. And every time, it's an inconvenience, right? Moving is always an inconvenience, especially if it's between here and Durban and other places. And because we've been working with people in the churches and ministries we've been doing, the default is we are put out for other people all the time, okay? And in your flesh, you think, why am I doing this? Like, why are we putting ourselves out? You know, like even right now, we're suffering inconvenience because there's a family in our house in Durban, and they waiting for another place to open, and until that opens up so we can move there, we're having to bounce around here. But it's become such a normal part of our life that it is an inconvenience, but it doesn't bother us. You know what I'm saying? It's just just what we've got to do, because that's God's purpose, you know? Like, for example, with Carol and Daryl, they're staying in our house at the moment because God's will is for them to be here, and we've had to make a space for them, but we can't go there, so you know, we've been camping this weekend, and it's actually, that inconvenience has been great for us as a family. It's forced us to go camping, and we've loved it. So God even works in the inconvenience. But you can either get irritated with God and irritated with people, or you actually go, oh, yeah, that's what it means to be a servant. We've got to serve each other. We've got to consider other people more highly than we do ourselves, and we've got to look to others' needs. That's what it says here in Philippians. He says here that we need to look to the needs of others as well, not just our own. So expect, if you truly lay your life down for Jesus, you must expect inconvenience, and you must look for God working in the midst of that inconvenience. Because, again, to become Christ-like means to produce the fruit of the Spirit, one of which is patience and the other one is long-suffering, all right? Which generally don't arise through pleasant circumstances. Okay. I still can't accept home affairs though as a place for learning. But anyway, that's fine. Yeah. I have my weaknesses. So is that encouraging you guys this morning? Just to reflect on these things and ask, are you easily put out? Are you easily irritated by inconvenience? Do you really understand that being Jesus' servant means he's going to use you as a servant? Like, people get upset about that. You know, I gave my life to Jesus, and now look at all this hardship and all this stuff and waste and this and that. It's like, yeah, that's what a servant, that's why you have servants, so they do all the stuff you don't want to do, you know? Otherwise, you'd do it yourself. The whole point of serving, that's what servants do. They do stuff that nobody wants to do, especially slaves. That's why slaves were so in for so many thousands of years, because you know they didn't have an objection, they didn't have a right to object. You know, it's like, go do X, and they just have to do it. Anyway, so my challenge and my encouragement is, let us be the doulos of Christ. Let us be the diakonos of Christ, his servants and attendants. Lay our lives down for him, for other people. Because if we say that we serve Jesus, what does that actually mean? He just uses us to serve people. And trust me, humanity, the brokenness of humanity and the selfishness of humanity and the blindness of humanity, in that mix, there's more than enough hardship and inconvenience and frustration to a minister, of a servant of the gospel, of which we are all ministers of the gospel. Okay, not just somebody who's ordained or appointed. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Maybe just quickly, are there any questions off that? Anyone want to ask any questions? Otherwise, we'll wrap that all up. Who here has a better understanding now of having to be a bondslave of Christ? Eh? I hope so. At least enough to get you thinking.
So you said that doulos has no rights. Does the diakonos have rights?
Yeah. So the diakonos... The diakonos definitely comes across as more of a paid servant. So it's somebody that's an attendant at a wedding or a household or household servant. It's a free person who's paid to do.